peaceful, isn't it? But then, imagine these sounds in your garden, in your house, and in your head 24/7. Apparently, according to all too common noise specifications, regulations, and ordinances, those sounds, these hums, don't exist. They are imaginary. Hums like these are all too common and are becoming increasingly common due to the current data center boom, excuse the pun. The elephant in the global noise evaluation room is that all too often the noise specifications that are supposed to protect communities from nuisance noise from all manner of sites are quite literally deaf to these hums. It's as though they are looking at rainbows through a filter that eliminates the colour red. It doesn't have to be like that. Our entire digital world, everything from streaming to cloud storage, all runs on the massive physical data centers that are being built across the planet. Unfortunately, these come with a hidden cost: noise. A persistent, pervasive, and annoying hum that's ignored by typical noise specifications and regulatory ordinances. This causes both ill health and eye-watering costs. Let's consider just one installation that shows exactly why they get this so very and expensively wrong. This quote says it all. A $5 million mistake plus $232,000 in fines for a lack of a 5-minute noise diagnosis. So a company throws $5 million at a noise problem. It fails, and they're hit with over $200,000 in fines. And the reason? Whoever advised them skipped a 5-minute noise diagnosis that resulted in the wrong, high carbon, and cost failure. My 5-minute diagnosis from the other side of the planet, taken from a KFYR TV news broadcast, shows exactly why. More on this later. This isn't just one bad decision. It's a sign of a much deeper and more common misunderstanding of the problem, not some isolated incident. Data center noise is generated by their massive cooling and power generation systems running 24/7. That's a major issue all over the world. From quiet towns to huge cities, communities are suddenly finding themselves living with a constant low-level drone that not only has serious effects on property values and quality of life, but also on health. The health consequences are second only to air pollution, causing serious increases in the rates of dementia, of strokes, and deaths from heart attacks. It doesn't have to be like that. The heart of the issue is that there's a serious disconnection. On one hand, there's what people are hearing, a deep bass hum that passes through walls and windows. On the other hand, you have the standard overall regulatory noise measurements that actually filter out the very low frequency hum that's the cause of so many complaints. The awaiting filter that's used in sound level meters removes the very components of the sound that cause these complaints. The standard measurement typically used in planning and to assess noise is literally deaf to the problem. Let's look at a case study that is a perfect illustration of this whole misunderstanding: the Atlas Power Data Center in Williston, North Dakota. This is where you see good intentions, serious community pressure, and a massive amount of money come together to create a costly failure. So, the company experiences a deluge of noise complaints about hum from the site. It gets advice that suggests they do what seems to be the logical and traditional thing. They build a noise barrier. If you make hammers, then all problems are nails. If you make noise barriers, then... not just any wall, but a truly massive structure at an eye-watering cost of $5 million. A big, brutal answer to the problem. Only it wasn't. What did they get for that $5 million investment? They got continued complaints from an angry community as the hum remained. And the most frustrating fact is that the failure was easily predicted by anyone who understood noise. It was completely predictable that the wall would be a $5 million eyesore and a massive monument to trying to solve the wrong problem. So, why did it fail so badly? The answer isn't about bad construction, it's about bad diagnosis, or in this case, no diagnosis. In order to understand why this huge wall didn't work, we first have to understand the nature of the sound that it was supposed to fight. That's the key question. How can a gigantic noise barrier be completely useless against the complaint sound? It seems to defy common sense. That's the problem. The common sense, typically embedded in noise ordinances and specifications, is often simplistic and limited. It doesn't address a major cause of noise complaints, as it's based on measuring just dBA, the A-weighted decibel. This measurement filters out the very low frequencies that are a common cause of complaints. It's like using a graphic equalizer to cut bass. It's all down to a basic principle of acoustics. Low-frequency sounds, like the deep hum from the site, are like ocean breakers with really long wavelengths, whereas the higher-frequency sounds that are measured using the classic overall dBA are more like ripples with short wavelengths. So, trying to stop hum with a barrier is like trying to stop an ocean breaker with a postcard. The sound energy just flows around it. $5 million bought a King Canute noise barrier that could not work. This TV news broadcast audio analysis trace is the technical smoking gun. Believe it or not, this complaint noise signature was created just by analysing a sample of the audio from a local TV news story about the complaints. It instantly shows that the problem was never the overall noise level, but a group of powerful, low-frequency tones based on a frequency of 118 Hz that was generated by the cooling fans. That huge spike, that's the hum, that's the real villain of the story. The analysis that lets you see the precise cause of the complaints is called narrowband frequency analysis. Think of it as a precise, perfect pitch tool compared with a crude conventional dBA mallet. And it's available to anyone as a free smartphone app. It doesn't just tell you the volume, it tells you the exact pitch of the sound and the exact cause. In this case, six-bladed cooling fans running at 1180 RPM. This was the simple skipped 5-minute diagnosis that would have saved millions. So, if building a $5 million wall was the wrong thing to do, what's the right solution? The best solution is not only effective, it's much cheaper and much greener. The truly elegant engineering fix is to stop the noise at source instead of trying to block the sound after it's been generated. You prevent the fans making the hum in the first place by using a computer model to understand the airflow. And then you design small, retrofit, aerodynamic components that kill the hum, performing precise acoustic surgery instead of constructing a castle around the site. The difference is truly dramatic. The wall is incredibly expensive, ineffective against the hum, an eyesore, and can cut cooling airflow. By contrast, the aerodynamic fix is low cost, kills the problem hum, is invisible, and, pause for effect, it can even make the data center more efficient. A surgeon's scalpel compared with a bludgeon. Quoting Arthur C. Clarke, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. In one corner, a massive, ineffective structure, and in the other, a low-cost, invisible modification that can cut energy use by making fans up to 20% more efficient. That means that a project to cut noise can literally pay for itself in energy savings, or even turn a profit. The elephant in this particular room is that knowledge of modern noise control techniques and technologies is generally truly abysmal, even amongst noise consultants. They tend to rely only on crude, high-cost palliatives such as enclosures, silencers, and of course, noise barriers. We're back to hammers on screws and nails. This story is about so much more than just one data center in North Dakota. It's a lesson for an entire industry, not to mention crypto farms and many other installations. It's also a message and a lesson for all the communities that host these facilities. If we want to avoid the ruinous impact on the lives of local people and multi-million dollar mistakes in the future, the rules of the game must be changed by introducing smarter noise ordinances and regulations. This means looking beyond simplistic overall decibel levels to address tonality, those annoying low-frequency hums in particular. We have used simple smartphone technology to evaluate and solve a host of these types of noise problems across the world, quickly and more sustainably. For example, we have developed a template supplier noise data sheet to capture tonal data. This usually has to be by asking the supplier for smartphone recordings of similar plant installed elsewhere. The data center models we generate as part of the design process to meet noise specifications always include tonal components. This is the only way to ensure that the site will not cause noise problems in the local community. More nuanced noise ordinances and sound studies need not be complex. After all, tonal analysis is available on smartphones for free. Noise modelling studies based on the same principles should be carried out by the designers and developers before anyone starts building. This is in sharp contrast to typical noise models that do not take into account low-frequency tonal noise. We have helped regulators in a number of countries re-evaluate noise ordinances and specifications to render them more fit for purpose. It's all about being precise and proactive instead of reacting only after generating widespread complaints, bad publicity, and bad health. Ultimately, the example of the wasted $5 million on Emperor's New Clothes isn't really about acoustics. It's about listening. It's about using the right noise analyses, asking the right questions, and choosing smart design over traditional high-cost and brute-force noise control palliatives. I'd like to leave you with this one final and really important question. As our digital world keeps expanding, how do we make sure that the multitude of massive monuments to the digital age that we are building are not just useful, but are also good, quiet neighbours in the communities that we all call home?